is a registered charitable trust from Panjim, and we have been doing a lot of work in connection with the Kampal Creek, the coconut issue, and various other matters. Today, we feel that Goa is at crossroads. A lot of contentious issues are hitting us in the face. So the concept of having a fathering Goa idea is because even in a family, if there is stress, if there are divisions, it is the father who is the ultimate arbiter. So fathering Goa is a way of taking this idea of bringing diverse forces together, and our topics are hot topics. The first one is communal harmony. The second is environment with a special effect on saving the waters of Goa. And the third is heritage and language. We have got some very interesting people for you in the panels, which includes Member of Parliament, Mr. Narendra Sawaikar, ex-Union Law Minister, Mr. Ramakanth, Khalap. We have also current Art and Culture Minister, Mr. Govind Gowde, Vivek Menezes, a well-known published writer, amongst others. So whatever you're going to hear and listen is what we're trying to present to you and asking Goa to come forward with new thoughts. Most of our old thoughts have been failed ones, and that's why we are struggling. But now is the time for each and every one of us to come forward and put our thoughts on the table and give this idea of fathering Goa a thrust, something new, something all-encompassing, something which is unifying. And along with fathering Goa, which is very much on Father's Day today, we also amazingly have Goa Revolution Day. So finally, we're talking of a revolution to bring the father figure, the all-encompassing loving figure into the fray. Happy viewing.
Hello and welcome to the Fathering Goa debate on Goa's Revolution Day. The theme for this debate is the concern with regard to the absence or presence of communal harmony in Goa. Before we move on to the debate itself, let me take some time to introduce the panel we have assembled today. I'd first like to introduce you to Ms. Pamela DeMello, who is a freelance journalist and has been in the field of journalism for about 25 odd years. Subsequently, we have Advocate Ramakanth Khalap, who for a Goan audience doesn't really need an introduction, having been an MLA, a minister in various Goan governments, has been a member of parliament, and has also been a central minister of law. And finally, but not least, the sitting member of parliament representing South Goa, the Honorable Narendra Sawaikar. So with this introduction, let me move on to the concern of this debate, which is a sense that in the past there has been a certain kind of communal amity within various communities in Goa, which seems to be dissipating in the present day. This concern is also augmented by the presence of lynch mobs in various parts of India, especially in northern India, with the kind of rhetoric issued by both elected members of government as well as other political actors. And since this is the context within which this debate is being conducted, perhaps I'll address the first question, or perhaps allow Mr. Sawaikar to open the floor. How would you respond to these concerns that a variety of people express? Do you think these concerns have legitimacy? They are illegitimate? How would you respond, also keeping in mind that you are associated with the central government in power?
So far as Goa is concerned, after liberation, we have been noticing in Goa, there is a communal harmony. The people all over Goa, right from Pernem to Kankon, and I think all the panelists on this panel would agree with me, that irrespective of the caste, creed, religion, Goans have been living together harmoniously, and there is a secular fabric which has been maintained throughout the state of Goa. See, sometimes there are some fringe elements making some statements, or there are some activities which are going on around. So, but that doesn't mean, because any government in power, whether it may be in the center or in the state, it always follows and it always goes by the dictate of the Constitution of India. So therefore, in my opinion, in fact, for so far as Goa is concerned, the communal harmony and brotherhood as between the Goans is concerned, we have been maintaining, and in fact it is the Goans have largely contributed, and in fact they have harmonized this kind of a harmonious kind of a situation in the state of Goa.
Maybe I'll ask Advocate Khalap to not only express your own opinion, but perhaps maybe also respond to Mr. Sawaikar.
To a large extent, I do agree with my friend Narendra Sawaikar that we have a fabric which is known for the harmony that we maintain, good relationship that various communities have with each other. But there are fringe elements, and particularly after the advent of the present government at center and also in Goa, certain people seem to have suddenly realized that they have some specific powers which are not in tune with what we all think of. Like a good farmer, the persons at the helm of affairs in Delhi as well as in Goa must send a good message to the public and to these fringe elements that no mischief will ever be tolerated. For example, the other day, our Chief Minister, Mr. Parikar, did a good thing. After those tourists were attacked in Merses, he gave out a very stern warning to the gundas, the mischief mongers in Goa, and directed the police that action be taken against them. If such a statement emanates from the powers that be, both in Delhi and in Goa, as regards people who are, you know, some seem to be so espousing the cause of some special religious whatever feelings that they have or the sentiments that they have, this fear psychosis may build up in course of time. It has happened over the last 3 years. Now there are lynch mobs, as we have seen. In many places they did come out. Someone comes and says, in Goa, if anybody eats beef, he should be hanged. Somebody else says that we should have a Hindu Rashtra in course of time. So these statements, when they go unchecked, and when people who are in power do not speak about it, these people become emboldened to repeat such type of things, and you know it may have repercussions in the days to come. So this is what I feel, and I expect and I hope that the present government in Goa and the government in Delhi will make right noises against this type of elements.
Thank you, Advocate Khalap. Ms. DeMello, would you like to intervene in the debate right now and make some opening statements?
Yeah, actually, I wanted to say that while I hope we can be insulated from what is happening in the rest of the country, because Goa has really been an oasis in the rest of India in terms of our record of people living together. You know, with minor differences, we have got over our differences. We have a policy of live and let live. I hope that really we can be insulated from what is happening at the center, because I unfortunately tend to see this as, you know, some kind of, you know, I don't find the center taking enough action against the people, against the fringe groups who are making these statements. In fact, I think people are being manipulated. We are being manipulated daily. If there is a crisis and the growth numbers of the country are down and we are saying, you know, demonetization has not worked, then you have somebody issuing a toxic statement in one part of the country. The minute there's some other farmers out on the street in Madhya Pradesh, you have another leader issuing another toxic statement. So if you time these statements to what is happening in the economic areas of the country, I see a correlation, and I wish the media would bring out that correlation, because we are being manipulated to fight against one another, and it's classic divide and rule. I feel that's an old policy which the current day rulers are using.
Fortunately, we have a strong democracy, and I feel as time goes on, democratic change itself will liquidate this, or at least dilute this type of thoughts, this type of elements that are there around us. But more than that, whoever is in power, he is expected to give out a very stern warning that communal harmony will be maintained at all cost, that this type of people who are creating all these troubles for the people will be taken to task. Unfortunately, this is not coming out. No responsible person at the helm of affairs seems to be at all disturbed by what is happening around. On the contrary, statements come about, well, everything is goody-goody, everything is nice and nobody, nothing is happening and whatever they are doing is the best thing that they are doing. This is not enough. That is not enough. Like a good farmer, you know, this is a monsoon season we have seen. With good rains, all sort of things grow up. But the pest, a good farmer controls the pest. So also, if BJP has come to power in Delhi, there will be people who say, hey, we are also BJP men, we can do whatever we want because our people are ruling here. But then the men of the affairs, like a good farmer, must see that these are pests, these are to be controlled.
Right. I think time and again, our leadership at the center, as well as in the state, has taken cognizance of this kind of issues and have always expressed their opinion on the issue. And we have been very firm in dealing with these kind of situations, whether at the center and whether it is in Goa.
Well, I'd like to intervene at this point. A number of the members of the panel have mentioned this term fringe elements. And I'd like to disagree. I don't think these elements are fringe anymore, but actually are rather central to the way in which the Indian polity is operating. I'd also like to disagree with Advocate Khalap in terms of this rhetoric about we have a strong democracy. I think if anything, what contemporary events are showing is that the democracy is in fact very weak. The republic is in fact in crisis, right? So pulling these ideas together and localizing it more in Goa, especially in light of your recent statement, we've recently had the Hindu Janajagrati Samiti, which has organized a meeting, which is openly called for the hanging of people. It has called for a ban on cow slaughter. It has asked for an overturning of the republic, the overturning of the constitution. And what is interesting is there hasn't been any action against this group. And against a group that has been systematically engaging in this kind of incitement of persons who would identify as Hindu.
See, some conference is organized in some place of Goa. One doesn't know what is their agenda. Okay, so because it's a democracy ultimately, so people will organize some conferences. They will address their gathering. They will espouse their causes, whatever it is. Now, so far as I am concerned, the party which I belong to, I was just thinking it to myself. From 2000 to 2002, for almost last 10 years, we have been in power in Goa. Now, I ask a question to myself. In our tenure, whether Goans or otherwise, for that matter, Goa has come across any kind of such situation or any kind of such incidents, which have not been, in fact, in the sense that a communal harmony is being disturbed or this kind of issues which are being raised during the when BJP is in power. This is one thing. Secondly, when it comes to such kind of issue, BJP is committed and any government for that matter, why BJP, but any government for that matter is committed and has to follow the dictate of the constitution of India, as I have said it earlier. And so therefore, if somebody wants to say that this is Rashtra, that is Rashtra, but when we say that we follow the constitution and there is a constitution at place and which has been adopted by the Indians right from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, I think we are committed to the constitution and we will follow the constitution. And whosoever, if somebody wants to take law into the hands, there is a government in place which will take action against it.
Well, that doesn't seem to be sufficient. We have instances when mere sloganeering by certain students and elsewhere, have invited criminal cases of sedition.
Yes. You must be referring to cases in Delhi, for example, in JNU.
So if one section of the populace faces sedition charges and the other section goes with whole hog, beating their trumpets and beating their drums and blowing their trumpets in this fashion, then it sends a wrong message. So the hand of law must act in an equitable manner. True. If you are strong against one element, you must be strong against the other element as well. Only then, a proper message will go.
So you suggest that the BJP government hasn't in fact been even-handed, that there is a tendency...
That seems to be the impression from all this. Though I would say that I'm not a pessimist. When you said you don't agree with me that the democracy is strong, I beg to disagree with you. democracy is strong. Democracy is always there's an element of disorder in democracy. Mm-hmm. We all know it, and things will go blow hot and cold. Things will happen. It's not the ideal form, but there is no better form of governance than democracy. Mm-hmm. That's all we all accept. So therefore, these elements, we should see to it that a wound does not fester. Mm-hmm. Some antibiotic has to be applied when some wound somewhere, even a pinprick, has to be taken care of. Otherwise, it festers, and that the whole body politic gets affected. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We should be very careful about that.
Ms. DeMello, would you like to intervene now?
Yeah, we are fortunate that over 70 years, we've built a strong democracy in India. But I fear that what the trend is now, that we are slowly undermining. We're seeing the undermining of all the institutions of democracy. The media is under attack, both because we are very corporate owned, and so therefore we are very amenable to corporate agendas. And the way in which, it's being undermined from within is scary. I think the people, not just the media, but the people who rely on the media for their source of information should also be worried, frankly. All the institutions are being systematically undermined. Our freedom of expression. If you ask too many inconvenient questions, there are people who have found cases against them. So it is, and there are open statements, questioning the kind of democracy. Also, I think the people of India should not just judge their rulers on the basis of what statements they make, but what they are actually doing. If you see what their actions are, it doesn't always match up to our constitutional rights and what we are supposed to get. So that should be a worry.
We're taking a break now. What I'm going to do is ask members of the audience to maybe identify themselves, raise a question, and please be brief in the question. Yeah. Your name.
I introduce myself Sudeep Dalvi. I am a pharmaceutical scientist, and my question is that whenever any element, right wing or left wing, tries to divide the society on the line of community, we will have to go a little bit deeper. What is the purpose? Dividing the community itself is not the purpose, it is just a mean. The purpose is to come to power. And if we analyze, if we turn back the pages of history, those people who are today sitting in seats of power in New Delhi as well as in Panjim, once upon a time they were involved into demolition of Babri Masjid. And that shows the level of commitment which they have towards constitution and towards Supreme Court. It's very clear about it. Second thing, today's fringe elements, so-called fringe elements like that Sadhvi and that Sanstha and all these people, they cannot act, work or survive without strong backing from the mainstream elements which are in ruling ends of the ruling corridors of power. Ultimately, my question is why the people who are sitting in power in Panjim have not objected to the statement of Sadhvi and got her arrested under the Seditious Activity Act, which is very much used prevalently in such cases, and stopped all this nonsense being happening when they could have easily done it. And why, when Pramod Mutalik's entry could be banned in Goa for so many years together, Sadhvi and Sansa's entry could be not? That is my question.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Dalvi. I think your question also echoes a number of the concerns that have been raised on my the left-hand side of the panel. So I think the question very clearly is to Mr. Sawaikar, as a member of the ruling government.
I would disagree with Mr. Dalvi to the extent that Babri demolition is it's a sub judice matter, and there are proceedings which are in the court, and in fact they are in the court, it's going on. So far as the statements which are, you talk about the statements coming out from some people here and there. In fact, I have answered this question first of all. As you have rightly pointed out in Pramod Mitalik's case also, because he had an intention to enter Goa with particular agenda. That's what I initially said, because there is a conference which is going on. We never knew what is the agenda of that conference, what they are going to talk about it, because I came to know about it yesterday. So now that the government knows about it, that something is being said, And it is for the state or the government of which is in place right now in the state, the chief minister or the home minister of the state, they will definitely look into this kind of issues.
Thank you, Mr. Sawaikar, for your response. I will take another question from the audience. If you can identify yourself. I first take Colin and then subsequently this gentleman
Linden.
Here. Pardon me?
Linden.
Linden. Yeah. So, Colin, if you can identify yourself for the camera.
Colin Quayler. I would like to ask the South Goa MP, since he's a member of the ruling party. This conference, as you said, you didn't know anything about it. But I think it has already been in the papers a week ago about what their agenda was. And all of us have read it. And 150 associations coming into Goa has been in the paper for a week. And secondly, I think this conference is not the first time being held in Goa. So I'm sure you have information. I think it's 3 years or more. I'm not sure, but 3 years I'm different. So why is it that nothing was done in anticipation of this?
See, you doing something in anticipation and you coming across some kind of a statement made by, rightly or wrongly, by some elements or otherwise for that matter by some orators or the some speakers in some conference. Now that the government has come across, see, you may, because there is, you see, as you said it, the last week suppose there was something came in place or somewhere something was said in the papers that there is going to be a conference. One can organize a conference tomorrow. If we put a ban on the conference, then they will approach the court and they will say that that's a freedom of expression or otherwise for them, that's our right. Fundamental right to organize the conference. How can you stop doing it? When in Pramod Mutalik's case, Pramod Mutalik specifically said that I want to enter Goa, then this is my agenda. And when the government came to know that if this is going to be the agenda and if this is going to disrupt the communal harmony in the state, then in such kind of a situation, there was a government, it was very same government, very same chief minister who stepped in and he said, no, you can't enter Goa. Now, in this case also, now yesterday, in fact, so far as I am concerned, I read it in yesterday's papers and perhaps maybe today's papers also because I had to rush for the program. So, when we came across, yesterday when I was discussing with the Chief Minister said that we are looking into it and definitely the government, the state is concerned with it.
So, I am going to just take a pause over here for a minute because I think a number of the questions are being directed towards Mr. Sawaikar and it's becoming more of an interrogation than the discussion we were hoping for. Mr. Sawaikar also has to leave right now. So, I am going to just end by thanking all members of the panel for their presence here, for sharing their opinions. And I'll end with the hope that perhaps the government in power will in fact act on persons who are engaging in seditious activities just as much as they do against students who very often don't espouse a Hindu nationalist agenda. Thank you all for being here. Thank you to the panelists and have a good day.